Okay, wonderful. Well, I think we should get started for the sake of time. We'll start just by introducing ourselves. My name is Regina Rosie Mitchell. I'm the Director of Entrepreneurship and Innovation, meaning that I help coordinate all of the fantastic programs that happen in our Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. Every single month, we have been putting on workshops just like this with the goal of inspiring making, creativity, joy, and connection. And we love doing this because we think that even though we're all apart, we love coming together as a community to create and connect over something maybe other than what we might be doing in our classes. So thank you so much for joining us. And we love seeing all of our visitors as well. So our theme for February is Valentine's Day. And today I am joined by some of my fantastic colleagues. We have Mr. Waito, who is our media studio specialist. He's there, he's recording today's session. So this will be available for those who weren't able to join us. And helping us manage our slides and all of our technical devices. And then our guest lecturer, so to speak, today is Ms. Danielle Ashton, who is a visual arts teacher at Marlboro. She teaches all sorts of seventh and eighth grade electives, ranging from digital art to sculpture to design. And so if you are thinking about coming to Marlboro down the road, you might be taking an art class with Ms. Ashton in the future. And she also teaches foundations in drawing and painting. So we thought we would start, you know, the theme of a lot of our workshops are both the art and science of, because in our Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, that houses our computer science program as well as our research program. And so we love to combine that idea of art and science into one. And so we thought we would kick things off with a few fast facts. We can go to the next slide. And Dr. Ponzio, who teaches, she heads up our honors research in the sciences program and also teaches psychology. She put these together for us. So five fast facts about the science of love. Okay, next slide. So friendships are voluntary relationships highlighted by strong emotional attachments. And research suggests that there are actually three components to that strong emotional attachment into what makes a strong friendship. Okay, so that can be everything from compatibility to emotional basis and shared or communal interests. Next slide. Smell, I thought this was quite interesting. Smell is actually the strongest sense tied to attraction. And so even as newborn infants, we can recognize our mother by her smell. And both men and women have, I think this is pronounced the apocrine glands. Someone else can correct me. And we have those all over, but mostly in our armpits. Okay, this smell, surprisingly, you know, helps drive attraction. That is not something I knew before. Next slide. The longest and most impactful relationship for most people is with their sibling. I loved hearing this one as well. I happen to have two siblings that don't live in Los Angeles, but I actually took a screenshot of this and sent this to them to let them know that it's a good thing we're still in touch and still close. Those sibling relationships are so important. I also think I need to tell my own kids that these relationships matter and that life events generally improve sibling ties. Okay. Marriage and having children have little effect on sibling ties, but divorce, widowhood, illness, or death of a close family member can strengthen the relationship. So keep our siblings close, and maybe today you'll be inspired to make a Valentine for a sibling. Okay, next one. The size of our social networks actually decreases in age, but that said, our social relationships become stronger. So as we get older, we tend to invest more time and energy into developing those relationships. And again, Valentine's, it's a great way to continue to foster those connections and build those relationships. And finally, millennials, okay, so those who were born approximately like 1980 to 2005-ish, again, that's always approximate, but those millennials are causing the divorce rate in the United States to plummet. And this trend is expected to continue for the next several generations. And there's all sorts of reasons why that might be the case. But one for sure is that millennials are delaying marriage and typically not getting married in their early 20s, but holding off on marriage until their late 20s or early 30s. Okay, so I think that's it for our fast facts about love. Give you a little bit of something to chew on and think about as we move forward. And maybe that's going to inspire you to make a Valentine for someone you weren't planning to. And I'm now going to pass it off to Miss Ashton.
Thank you so much. I'm thrilled to be here and to make a few Valentines with all of you today. I know that the hardest part about making a Valentine is finding the time to just stop and focus on those that we love. You know, even though we're in distance learning and in a new environment, it's still tricky to slow down and just rest with thoughts of those that we love and to make them a Valentine. So let's do that today. So I'm going to give you an introduction, and then we're going to do some techniques together and make a couple Valentines before you leave today. So that way, when the time is over between us, you have a Valentine to share, and you still have some inspiration to keep going if you're motivated to. Okay. I'm so happy to see you all. Let's get to work. First thing, let's see. I like to always start with a little sort of, I'm not a person of words. I'm definitely a visual artist. So everything about how I approach my life tends to be very much leaned on visuals and less words, but I like to start with a little something. So mailing a letter warms the heart, not only for us that share it, but those who receive it. My children still, who get maybe 5 letters a year, run to the mailbox every day to see if there's something in the mail. And fortunately for my son today, there was a little something from his grandma today in the mail. So it's really exciting when we receive mail. It's a moment in time shared amongst friends and family too. So a little history about mail art. So first time I was experienced mail art, I was in high school, and it was a really cool thing to create these letters. Friends were heading off to college. We had siblings or summer work. A lot of us had summer jobs where we would take off and work in the Northern Canada, and mailing letters became a way that we stayed connected. It was popularized in 1973 by a gentleman by the name of Ray Johnson. So he decided that he wanted to create a little bit more correspondence between him and other artists. And so he started creating mail art. Now, mail art had already, you know, it was nothing new per se. Duchamp was already, you know, talking about it. It was definitely a part of a visual language amongst artists, and globally too, very much so. So he started this group called the New York Correspondence School. And essentially it was the first Instagram, let's say, right? It keep passing amongst friends, right? Visuals. And having that visual connection. So I kind of like this. I like to think of like all the ways in which we've built up to today. If you are on Instagram, there are a lot of people post their mail art. So yesterday, this hashtag mail art, I took a look at it and was looking through some of the examples and was getting inspired. And today I went back to look, and there were so many new posts on mail art that I couldn't find the original ones that I found the day before. So that's how popular this is, and how many people are sending art through the mail. I'd love to see, you know, I'd love to hear what the post office has to say about all this mail art. So I like to send them, and I like to send teeny tiny ones to see if they get through the mail. And then I like to send, like, how big can I get that envelope and what can I make of it? So if you have a couple of friends who are really into it, you guys can just sort of push the limits on what you can mail. It's a lot of fun. So what you need today, you need a recipient. Okay. So you have to think of somebody, someone close or far that you would like to create a Valentine for. I even mail Valentines to those in my house because it's still really special, even though they live with me, to go to the mailbox and receive it in the mail and to pull it out of the box. It's like a little present, right? So it can be a sibling. You know, we were talking about that earlier. It can be a sibling or in my case, a spouse, a partner, or if I, you know, if I lived with my extended family. So think of who you would like to focus your attention around today, because those friendships generally are what can inspire us. Okay. Envelopes. Everyone should have envelopes in their packet. If you didn't receive a packet, don't worry about it. Just get a scrap piece of paper today, because some of these ideas you want to just sort of play with anyway, right? You might not want to go straight to the envelope. But go ahead and buy yourself a big box of envelopes at some point, and you have it there to always go to, right? We don't always have to do this in Valentine's. Tools. We have paint in our kits. We had paint pens to work with, which are these little tools here, right? These little pens. And then if you have anything else around your house, color pencils, graphite pencils, ballpoint pens are great. The other thing we're going to want is a little jar of water. Now, you don't have to get it yet, because I'm going to stop talking at some point, and you can grab some of these supplies to bring to your space before we start working. So anything that you can put on an envelope. We're not going to talk about this today, but collage is very much a technique used for mail art. So that would also be something you can use, okay? And then stamps. You want some stamps. I buy a sheet and have them in my house at all times. If I'm heading to the drugstore or the supermarket and I'm running low, I'll make sure that I get a new one. So here are some of the envelopes that I started playing with, and the idea behind mail art. So it can be any style that you already have in your back pocket. You don't have to be a visual artist to enjoy it. Doodling, when I was doing this in high school, my friends who were doing this, none of them were art students. They were just kids running around the world, having a great time, wanting to stay in touch. So please feel free to express who you are with a pen and a pencil, and use that and bring that with you today. So the cassette tape cracked me up. I saw that somebody had something like that. So I was inspired by them, and I just created a cassette. It's really, if you Google like something, like if you have a friend that you like to play a certain game together with, you know, go ahead and find an image that you can sort of start with, and then I'll just take an outline and draw it. I am a big fan of florals or mandalas, where you go around and you just doodle around and around, and I just like to focus on my friends and think about memories and use shapes and colors. Okay. These paints are great. We're going to get them wet, and you can manipulate them a little bit further. Okay. So if you have a paintbrush, at home, you can bring one of those to the table today. And if you don't have a paintbrush, a cotton swab will do you too. Okay. Anything to get the paper wet. So whatever you have that will work. Okay. The other thing is a ballpoint pen. Ballpoint pens are spectacular because they're always in your pocket, right? Well, not in your pocket necessarily, but they're handy. There's always a hotel pen somewhere in the house. So if you don't have any, you know, big art supplies, use that. And graphite, you know, we think it's erasable, right? But if it rains, it's not going to wash away. So you can use that. Okay. So graphite is also something else you can use if you have no paints. Okay. Like I mentioned before, I'm not a big wordsmith. I'm more of a visual artist. So I like to fill my letters, not necessarily with letters, but with games or clippings or collages. So one of the games I like to play with a friend of mine is I Draw, You Draw. So this is just a page out of a book. I collect a lot of 50 cent books from the library, and I'll just cut it out and we'll just start painting on it together. I'll mail it to her. She mails it back to me. I mail it to her. And back and forth. And it's a fun little game that we play with each other. And this one we just did in last November. So even today, we're still playing this game together. And if those of you who have kits, these cards that cards that came in the envelopes, you can do that with these, an I draw, you draw kind of thing. The dog here is a clip out from the National Geographic. I have a friend who loves dogs, and just a little moment to warm her heart with these cute little images. A collage also works. The other thing, sometimes what I do is I just stuff the envelope with cutout hearts. Nothing said, just an envelope of cutout hearts. And that's all the moment needs sometimes, okay? So be yourself with these envelopes. So there are some ideas for you. In the kits, there was also one other item in it. And I just want to, because I know if I stop the slides and I don't bring it up, I'm gonna forget. So there was a little token in there, a little wooden token, okay? This is something that a student reminded me to think about. We were talking about in our design class, we were talking about things that were important to us, and we were designing wearable art that would express what was important to us. And one of the students had mentioned self-love. And we are really relying on ourselves lately, and we need to give ourselves a little love too for all the hard work we're doing, all the focus we're putting into our lives. So today, I also want you to think about you, okay? Give yourself a little love, a little gratitude, okay? So you can save that token for yourself. I made one and I hung it on my water bottle because it reminds me every time I go to take a drink of water. I'm doing it. I'm doing my best. I'm in it. And I hold a lot of gratitude for myself. You got to do that sometimes. Okay. So that's a lot of words for someone who said they don't do a lot of talking, but here we go. Let's paint together. Okay. So if you don't have a kit, grab anything that you have around your house, color pencils, crayons, pens. And if you do have the kit, go ahead and grab yourself a little water. It doesn't have to be a lot, just a little bit. And find either if you have a little paintbrush in your house, or if you don't have any paintbrushes, grab yourself a couple of cotton swabs, okay? And I'm gonna play a little song. So that gives you some time to go and gather your supplies. If you don't wanna mess up an envelope while we practice techniques, you're welcome to just grab any kind of scrap paper that you have around, okay? And we're going to do a couple of things together. I'm going to play a song.
And again, if you have a question, I would say it's probably easiest if you pop it in the chat.
We hear the music now.
Okay. Yes. Sorry about that. And then I went right over. I'm so sorry about that.
It's all good.
Oh my gosh. I just put my headset away.
So, Miss Ashley,
that went so.
That's when we lose your head. The music is when you put your headphones on, I think.
Yeah, and I had it all sorted. I had my foundation students help me with that today, and I thought I had it solved. But technology always likes to keep us on our toes, right?
Always.
So, maybe we'll figure out. I might just have to take my headset out when we. When we paint independently. So I'm going to stop sharing my sound.
Okay.
And I'm going to start sharing. Did we have any questions that I need to answer before we move on? Because I missed some of the things you said.
Yeah. So if anyone has the chat, since we are such a large group, the chat is the best place for questions. Let's see. I do see a question. Are we allowed to use paint from our house?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. We definitely encourage resourcefulness and the idea of using what you have. Mm-hmm. And then I see another question too. Are we supposed to have the paint already, or is it in those marks? Yes. And so if you got a Valentine kit, you should have gotten a few markers that are paint markers. And I think Ms. Ashton will talk about how to use those. But otherwise, like any, even if you don't have paint in the house, that's totally fine. Even a ballpoint pen is just fine. Colored pencils, markers, whatever you want to use.
Yeah. Yeah. Perfect. Okay. So I think we're ready. I think everyone's had a couple minutes to get started. So I'm going to change my camera to my studio table here. If my window is not in your space, go ahead and pin my Zoom window there. I'm Danielle Ashton. And that way you can see me. Sometimes it doesn't always work. So here's my space, and I'm going to get started here. So one of the things that I really enjoy doing, I'm a huge doodling fan, and I really enjoyed this design here. And I'll show you how to use the paint pens for something like that. I just think it's something so simple, and you can use it in so many ways. Here it is used again. So we're just straight using the pen. So if you don't have the paint pens, you can do this with marker or pencil or ballpoint pen. And then after that, I'm gonna show you a quick tutorial on how to use these pens and manipulate them a little bit more and make them sort of watery and soupy, okay? Here's one of the ones I did as a ballpoint pen. I actually used this idea from my students' elementary days where you blow a kiss. Okay, so let's do that. So you have these pens. If you don't, just go ahead and get your watercolor paints or anything that you have handy. If you open these lids, you're left with just a white tip. The pen hasn't been activated. And to activate the pen, what you want to do is just on a scrap piece of paper. I'm going to use my sketchbook here from class. This is perfect. I'm just going to push it a couple of times. I'm going to push the nib into the pen, and it's going to allow the paint to slowly come down the nib. This nib is plastic. Okay, so now I have the paint has been activated, and it's now at the end of the tip. Okay, so I can now paint with it. So go ahead and open up all those paint pens that you have and just push on them a little bit. So now that it's activated, every time I push it, it leaves a droplet of paint. It's been really fun playing with these. I haven't been a big paint pen fan until my daughter, who is in middle school, she loves them. She paints with them all the time. And I thought, well, it's time. It's time I start painting with these. So go ahead and activate those. Now, one of the things I'll tell you while you're opening them is when I was using them this week, this is acrylic paint, so it is permanent. And one of the things I found was every time I opened a cap and I would, you know, they get stuck because the paint kind of jams the lids. I'd go to open it and it would shake and then paint would go everywhere. So what I've started to do is use a cloth and I'll just sort of very slowly open it. And then if it splatters directly onto the cloth. So if you're using any kind of paint pen, I recommend that. So there's some other tips. All right. I have a little brush. I have some paint pens. So I'm going to get four colors. I think most of us have four colors to play with. Okay. So I'm going to use a pink and let's do a green and a purple and a silver. Okay. All right. Oh, darn. If it goes out of focus a lot, I'm sorry. My back is to the camera a little bit. My studio is set up this way. Okay. I'll try and pay attention to that. So let's
go ahead. Or the envelope.
You are welcome to do it on either, whatever you would like to start on. Yeah. If you want to start on the envelope or the card, either way. I'm going to do the envelope just because that's where my attention has been. But if you want to paint on the card, you're welcome to. Okay, you can create like your own stationery. So I want to leave a little bit of space for the address, but everywhere else I can sort of crawl and bring the paint everywhere. So I'm going to start with one of the techniques I like to use. So I'm going to open this up. I want to give it a little bit of a shake. Okay, not too much because I don't want it to splatter everywhere. You can also, if you want to shake it a little bit more aggressively, you can put the cap on, give it a shake so the medium inside the pen is ready. And let's just draw a couple of wiggles down the line, down the envelope, or the card, whichever you want to do. Or if you're doing an eye draw, you're starting an eye draw, you draw with a friend, you're welcome to do that too, okay? And let's just draw a line. So we're drawing with plastic right now. And if the paint is not gliding down that plastic nib, you just want to give it a little slight squeeze on the paper so that nib retracts inside and it allows the paint to come outside, okay? And then just bring it down, okay?
If we already have an idea, can we go with that?
You bet, absolutely, please do, yeah. I'm gonna just sort of talk about the temperament of this paint, of the pens. And then you are welcome to spend this time doing however you wish, absolutely. I'm glad you asked that, okay? So now I'm just gonna do some U's inside. So I'm gonna do a little U there. I'm going to do another little U, maybe more of a V. And I'm going to create these little dandelions all around the paper. Now I'm going to grab another color. If I'm not using one, because this is acrylic paint, it dries really quickly. Uh-oh, lost my cap. There it is. You want to, even if you just do it gently, you don't close it all the way, you do still want to put the cap on it so it doesn't dry while you're waiting for it. So now I'm going to grab a different color and I'm going to use this little thing, shake it, open it. And now I'm going to use the nib to my advantage. So I'm gonna drop the paint on the pen on the paper and I'm gonna push down so it leaves this little drop. I'll see if I can get a little closer here. Okay, so I'm actually sort of essentially spilling paint onto the envelope by pushing down on the nib and allowing an excess amount of paint to fall on the envelope or the painting. Okay. So I'm going to do that all the way down my dandelions here. I worked with a wonderful woman who collected dandelions for photo shoots. So she would go around looking for whole dandelions and she would ship them around the world. Can you imagine trying to keep them from falling apart? So here's a technique that I love to use. And I'm gonna come back, actually, I'm gonna use the pink again. I'm gonna open that up, give it a shake. So the whole idea of spilling the paint, let's give that a try. So if you just push all this paint and you literally put a puddle on the paper, and you can do this with watercolor. You can do this if you have other paints in your house right now. And I'm just going to create a puddle. And with that puddle, I can then add I think I'll use this green. And I'm going to drop a little bit of green right in the center and it's going to kind of ooze in and it creates this sort of painterly space. Okay. And you can do that all over. These paint pens are great for playing and being able to take this sort of on the road with you. Okay. The one thing I did notice when you do this sort of spilling technique is you want to work from right to left or left to right, depending if you're right-handed or left-handed, because you, I did end up last weekend and you can see I'm starting to get little piles of paint on my hand. So be mindful of that because it does take these puddles some time to dry. Okay. So that's another little thing you can fill the page with. The other technique that I really love, I'm going to grab a different color so you can see it. And this is when I would use like a wet cotton swab or a paintbrush, depending on what you have. Let me just bring my water into the, okay. So I'm going to just dip into the water and I'm going to make a puddle of water on my envelope, on my paper. And I'm going to trace that puddle with my pen. And you can see immediately, oopsie daisy, immediately that it goes into this puddle. I'm going to do that again. So I dip my water. Oh, it's out of focus. I'll let it focus. Come on. There we go. And I've got a little puddle of water there and I'm gonna take my pen and I'm just gonna drop it in there. And you can see that it just disperses beautifully. So you can create these sort of watercolor flowers. And so I'm just pushing the paint out of the pen. I'm not really drawing. I'm just sort of playing with the color and making these sort of soupy flowers. And you can do this for like, if you're drawing a cassette or like whatever your subject is, you can still use this same technique. So I did it for like portraits. Let me see if I can find my funny looking portrait. I love to draw little funny looking portraits. So here it is, this is dry. So here's this technique dry where you make these little puddles in these dots. And then this one I did by sort of scribbling all over my envelope. And then once I'm done here, I'll show you how I did that. So if I come down and I make my leaf, I can now take a wet paintbrush with just clean water and I can move that paint around. And I can do that all the way around. So if you're doing like a doodle or something, you can do the same thing. You can use these same techniques for whatever subject you're using. Okay. I'll then go in once it's dry, like tomorrow, I'll go in and I can add some more details. Like on this one here, if I'm doing something like this where I'm just sort of doing a meditative design to share with my friend, I can then go in once the paint is dry and add more details on top. These paint pens really lean towards doing pointillism. It can be very calming to do something like this. Okay. So you can use up the whole envelope. I've seen artists who go ahead and use the backside, then you open it up and they have like another drawing right here. The whole gamut, like you can literally spend all night doing this, decorating these envelopes. And that in itself is a joy to receive in the mail. What are some other techniques I can show you? So here is the one I use for just pencil. And it's very quick. It literally took me 30 seconds, but it's just a little something to add to an envelope, right? To make it special. I have a friend who's always giving me agave plants. And so I would send this to her. Okay. I'm gonna just give us a little time to actually create these Valentines. I'm going to take my earbuds out and we can just paint together for a little bit. Any questions? Do we have any questions that I can answer?
The chat looks pretty empty. So I think if you do have a question, feel free to, if you have a question for Ms. Ashton, you can certainly chime in and ask it or feel free to use the chat, but yeah, I think people are just listening and creating.
Okay, fantastic. There's one other thing that I thought was really cool too with these paint pens, and you can do this with just anything really, is I grabbed myself a little tiny cap from a juice bottle. We do recycling in our house and the caps get left behind, and I use them in my paint studio. So I've just added a little bit of water, and if I want to drain some paint out of these pens, I can by essentially doing what we were doing with the paper, and I'm just going to push on that nib inside the water to create a little puddle. And I can then use my cotton swab, and I can paint the envelope. So you don't even need a lot of resources, and you can do this with the watercolor that you already have. And you can paint these beautiful, beautiful designs and just play. If you have a paintbrush, it makes it even a little bit easier for control, but I've actually come to enjoy painting with these cotton swabs. They're really soft and allows me to be a little bit more playful and less, less looking for perfection. Okay. All right. I am going to, it got dark in the studio suddenly. I have three lamps on my workspace. Can you believe it? And it's still this dark. It's crazy.
I know, the camera kind of adjusts and then it makes everything darker. That happens to me all the time.
Right? It's crazy. I'm going to take my earbuds out so we can play a little music and just spend a little time painting together. If you have any questions, go ahead and add them to the chat and I will make sure to answer them for you.
And Miss Ashton, actually, there is one quick question. If we can we use any marker to do the watercolor technique?
Well, that's a really good question. So the thing with paint pens, this is acrylic paint. So when it dries permanent. But if you have a water-based marker, if it gets wet, like let's say you're mailing this to New York, and there's a huge snowstorm, the marker can actually bleed again, where this acrylic will dry more permanent. But if you have alcohol-based markers that are permanent, like Sharpies, man, Sharpies are the best. This would be fantastic. Go ahead and Sharpie this envelope. Like, I love how vibrant and brilliant they are. I'm gonna grab my Sharpies now that it's been mentioned. You know, my other favorite tool to work with when I'm doing stuff like this is the good old highlighter. I mean, all these neon bright colors, fantastic. Like, I love highlighters so much. And look at all that.
And they're not water-based, because like if you have a Sharpie highlighter, you know, it's kind of the same thing.
That's right. That's right. And then color pencils are grease-based, so you can use color pencils. And, you know, unless you have a specific water-based color pencil, but traditional color pencils that you get are permanent. So those are perfectly fine. And, you know, we talked about collage. Once, you know, this painting dries, you can collage too. Now, the glue sticks are washable, but I say, you know, sometimes you just got to do it. You just have to hope it gets through the mail and not too much happens. And then sometimes maybe that's the fun of it, is that a little corner sort of, I just received a letter that didn't make it through the mail, and it's okay. I'll try again. It happens. And then all these techniques, you can apply the same techniques to the little tokens. Okay.
a few more questions, Miss Ashton. Thought this was interesting. Can the acrylic paint pen ink come off on your skin? I'm guessing.
Yeah,
it can. Okay, that can sometimes, yep, you can might have some.
Yeah. So if you get it on your skin, what I do is you have to sometimes take a brush to it to get it off your skin, but it will slough off because your skin is actually sloughing off. So, you know, a lot of times I'll keep a baby wipe or like a wipe. I try not to use these too much because they're not great for our environment. But if I know I'm using a really messy material, I'll wipe it before it dries.
Oh, that's a great
also tip. Sometimes lotion helps get off acrylic paint because I use it a lot. So
yeah, that's right. Lotion your hands. Yeah. And it'll degrease. That's right. Good hint.
And then one other question. With a Sharpie, would you use alcohol instead of water to get that bleeding effect?
Absolutely. Yes.
Yeah, it looks really pretty.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, that's right. Perfect. Great suggestions. Absolutely. And again, I'll just pour a little bit of rubbing alcohol into a water bottle cap and bring it to the table. I've learned from my own mistakes and in teaching in, you know, schools where we have a lot of people moving. The smaller the container of water that you have available to yourself is actually more beneficial. And then you can just change out that water when it gets dirty because it is bound to spill. Yeah, Ella, I can see, Ella, you have your hand up.
Yeah, also another cool trick to do since these are acrylic based, in our project I've tried before is taking like watercolors or as you could use the watercolor pencils and then just taking salt and putting it on top of it, it causes a chemical reaction in the paint causing it to make cool patterns.
Yes, I'm so glad you mentioned it, Ella. We are doing that right now in our foundations class, and I happen to have some salt right here. I love that you mentioned that. Thank you for sharing. I'm going to fill this cloud with some paint here, and I'll demonstrate it. Great idea. I'm just going to use this. So what happens is the salt absorbs the water and the water drags the pigment with it. And so it creates almost like a sparkle effect. The only thing you want to do though, is you're going to put this to the side now and let that dry. So you can see how the salt has quickly absorbed water and pigment around it. I'm going to let this dry and tomorrow I'll wipe that salt off. If I wipe the salt off now, it'll ruin the effect. You want it to dry first. Great suggestion. I love it. I love it. Oh, actually, if we're doing thinking of ideas like that, the other thing that's really fun is to you can do like a glazing. You just get some watery paint and glaze over your subject. And then I like to use tissue. So any of my foundation students who are here right now, they'll know this. We're talking about all of this right now. Is you can then take a tissue and dab it and you create a texture. You create a texture with the paint and you want it, you can put multiple layers of color over top. So it creates this really pretty effect. Anybody else have any wonderful suggestions? I love this that you guys are adding.
Yeah. So I made a card for a friend. And when I did the salt effect, the salt dried on there. And if you hold it under the light, it looks kind of like sparkly, like a if you just sprinkle crushed crystals, because that's what salt is, onto something. When it dries, it looks really pretty because it has all that pigment in it.
So your suggestion would be to keep the salt on it, like don't take it off. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Ah, I love it. So like a natural glitter. It's natural glitter, right? Love it. Thank you.
Well, I have a suggestion. My sister, she likes, you know, I did her favorite restaurant. But what I'm doing is I'm doing like a little pack of fries and out of the paper and I'm like making kind of a 3D thing.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Love it. Oh, that reminds me. Yes. Like when you have these folded cards, right? We have these. I like to just sort of take my scissors, and this is a really easy way to create a little pop-up, and I'll just cut a slit down. And then I just reverse the cut, and then I can add like a little pop-up right there when the card is open, and it's kind of fun, right? And then oftentimes I'll do like a little collage over here. You can do another paste over here. Lots to play with.
Ms. Ashton, we have a couple of questions from Ella Rose and then Madeline.
Okay. Sounds good. Ella, go ahead.
I have a suggestion. So, I mean, usually when I do any like paint, I usually wait until the painting dries and I add white highlights so it like pops and adds like more depth, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, I have to wait till it dries because then it'll smudge, but I think that's just something cool.
Yeah, I love that. I love that idea of like, you know, that even shows more time in the painting, right? When we take the moment to let it dry and come back. So these white pens are great. Let me just, oh, no, my paint isn't dry enough. I can't do it. But yes, that is a fantastic idea. Great job, Ella. Madeline.
I also have a suggestion. Sometimes if you, before you do the watercolor, you can get a like a waxy crayon and just like draw a little design, and when you put the watercolor over it, it sort of outlines the wax and it kind of repels from the wax. It's really cool.
Oh, I love this. Yes, keep these ideas coming. Absolutely. See how endless this is? We just received a pack of neon crayons, and look at that, beautifully sharp. But yes, absolutely, like a wax resist.
Ms. Ashton, we have a couple more hands raised here. We have, okay. I believe it's Shaylee and then Tally.
Okay,
it's Shaylee.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. But can I use an Expo marker to do the watercolor effect?
You know what? I always encourage kind of testing ideas. I think that's a great idea. Go ahead and test it and see, because I'm actually not too sure what the chemical properties are of an Expo marker. So what I would do is play with it with all these techniques, and then tomorrow go back to it and just test a wet brush on it and see what happens. See if it moves. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Couple more hands raised. Tally, and then Blake. Okay. And then...
Hi. So I used one of these heart wood things, and I put water on it. I tried to color the water, but I don't have a cap, so that didn't work out well. And yeah. Then I did when you recharge your paint, I put that down, and it makes a really cool, like just a dot that goes into a line. And I just thought that was really cool.
That is really cool. Perfect. I love that you guys are experimenting. This is really, this playfulness comes through in your Valentine. I love this. This is great.
We have Blake, and then okay. Khadija, and Nia, and Zara, I believe.
All right, let's do Blake, Khadija, and Zara. Let's do that.
So I like, well, I'm doing it for my sister who's in college right now. But I like put a bunch of like the paint on, and I like sort of shook it.
Yeah.
Is that like, would it dry like that?
Yeah, it'll dry like that. I love that. Very, Jackson Pollock, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Absolutely. That's going to dry permanent. Perfect. Yeah. Deja.
Hello. So I came up with a couple of ideas for like the cover. I was kind of wanting to make a bunch of different covered cards and then send them out to people. But one of them was like making these banners. I'm not sure if you can see it, but like there, heart banners. And then another one was, this one didn't turn out very good, but like a 3D heart. Like represent those candies. They're not very good. Well, at least in my opinion. But yeah.
I love it. Thank you for sharing. That's wonderful to hear. I love it. Thank you. Nia.
I was going to ask if this
exercise would work with charcoal or chalk?
Great question. I would not use charcoal and chalk for this exercise, because when it goes through the mail, it will be just disrupted too much, and you're going to lose a lot of the work, and the charcoal is not going to stay with it. The way that you can use charcoal if you'd like to is if you have like a spray that you can put on afterwards, but you want to do that outside and you want to have like a backdrop for it. So if you have like a clear spray that you can put over top, which is essentially a clear acrylic paint, hairspray can work.
Why not? I used it in my art class because it was all indoors pre-COVID, and we used hairspray on our pastel and charcoal drawings.
Yeah. I say give it a try. And it also creates a conversation. So you can ask the person you mailed it to, what does it look like? How did it, like, maybe that's part of the fun, is that it will be disrupted throughout the process of going through the post. So you could ask them, what's it look like? What, you know, did it work? You know, right? I love that question. Great idea.
You can also put tape over the charcoal.
Mm-hmm. You can. Love it. Keep them coming. Yeah, you're welcome. Excellent question. Sylvia, did you have a comment or a question?
I actually had a random suggestion. So if anybody, like, I'm sending a card to like a younger cousin and he's turning 2. So I decided, and he loves frogs. So I decided to make a frog, and when you opened it, it would show his mouth. So I was thinking that, like, you know, with the envelopes, you can like do something interactive with it. So I feel like that's.
Yeah, perfect. I love that. Yes. Ella.
I know how to make pop-up cards.
Yeah, so just a tip, because I am all over like using the wooden hearts, and I do know that wood absorbs water or the paint pens. So I forget who mentioned it earlier, but they said, oh yeah, it runs into a line. And in case you guys wanted to use like matte colors for places on your thing without them running, I'd recommend colored pencils, because they give a more pigmented look and it just gets really nice solid color on there. So I use that a lot.
Love it. Yeah, right? Because it's more of a greasy pigment than a liquidy pigment. I love that suggestion. Great. Now I'm going to go give that a try. And I like these ideas like layering them, right? So you can start with a watercolor technique, let it dry, come back, use the color pencil over top, right? And keep going with it. And then set an alarm to make sure you get these in the mail by Friday, because it looks like we're just gonna have too much fun doing this until Friday. Thank you everyone for your participation in this. It really you know, gives us all a lot of ideas to work with. So thank you.
Yeah, I think that, you know, I'm going to always keep an eye on the clock. We're nearing the end of the workshop. And so we just want to thank you all for coming. I know that I was so inspired by hearing all of your ideas. And I think I'm going to spend the rest of my evening getting my Valentine's ready and sharing those and getting those out in the mail. So feel free to stay on for a few more minutes. We can even, you know, unmute ourselves and thank Miss Ashton for teaching
us. Thank you so much.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
This was really fun.
Thank you. Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for coming. Have a happy rest of your day and a wonderful Valentine's Day. Spread the love.
Thank you.
Share the cheer.
That was so much fun.
Oh, good. So glad you could join us.